start with the definition of the gait. Human gait is defined as bipedal, biphasic forward propulsion of the center of gravity of human body, in which there are alternate sinuous movement of different segments of body and with least expenditure of energy. So if you understand, there are few important points. It has to be bipedal, biphasic forward propulsion of the body, and there has to be least energy expenditure in the gait. Some books has also defined it as the highly controlled, synchronous, soundless, rhythmic, and cyclic movement. So emphasize on the synchronous. It has to be synchronous, it has to be soundless, and rhythmic. Cyclic, because the same cycle gets repeated, so it is a cyclic movement of locomotor system of the body. As the body propel forward, the center of body, with minimum energy expenditure. So if you understand, in both the definition, there is too much of emphasis given on minimum energy expenditure. In the gait, whenever we are talking about the forward propulsion, what is the purpose? What are we doing actually? There is a translatory progression of the body as a whole, produced by coordinated rotatory movement of the body segment. And the lower extremity actually carries the weight of the head, arm, and trunk. So this is the head, arm, and trunk, which is also called as a passenger, and the lower body as a locomotor system or the transporter. So the aim of gait is that the locomotor system or transporter should carry the passenger from one place to another with minimum energy expenditure, and the passenger should be always be comfortable. Suppose you are sitting in a bus or a car. So what is the aim of the passenger sitting in the car? He want to be more comfortable, not to be disturbed from the movement of the car, and the journey has to be very smooth. So same is the objective of the locomotor system. It has to move in a such a rhythmic, synchronous, soundless pattern that the passenger should feel comfortable. So why do we need to study gait? Every disease affects gait. Ultimate measure of correct management, because gait is assessed in most of the diseases, it is supposed to be one of the ultimate measure of correct management. And a pre-operative planning and post-operative planning documentation is also needed. So based on the previous gait and post gait, we can talk about if the operation helped you or not. Or more commonly, improvement of the gait is prime importance to the patients as well as the therapist. Whenever any patient comes to us, especially in neurological population, one of the common expectation of every patient is that can they walk and how they walk. So walking is always given a lot of importance in our day-to-day therapeutic environment. So before we discuss about the kinetics and kinematics of a gait, all of us should always focus first on the purpose of the gait. We need to understand what is the purpose of the gait, and based on that, your assessment and treatment should be based on the purpose of gait. So what is the first purpose of the gait? As I just discussed with you in the previous slide, it is supposed to support head, arm, and trunk. The passenger has to be supported and made comfortable while walking. Second purpose, maintenance of the upright posture and balance of the body. So throughout the gait, the body has to be upright posture and it has to be balanced. The more imbalance of the upper body is also called as simply abnormal gait. Achieve safe ground clearance and gentle heel strike and toe landing. So whenever we are walking, we are supposed to focus on foot clearance. The foot has to be smoothly be clear during swing phase, and during stance phase, there has to be gentle heel strike, gentle landing, as well as heel or toe landing has to be gentle. Generation of mechanical energy to maintain the present forward velocity or to increase the forward velocity. This is very commonly neglected in our therapeutic setup, that we do not focus on generation of velocity by the body. Because the more you are able to generate a velocity of the body through the low limb forces, especially such as plantar flexors or push-off, that generates the forward propulsion of body, and it can also help you to increase or decrease the velocity. And the last purpose is absorption of mechanical energy for shock absorption and stability. or to decrease forward velocity of the body. So whenever we are going into landing phase, such as stance phase, there has to be shock absorption of the body, and while you are absorbing the shock, there has to be good stability of the foot so that the foot forms a good base of support for the next gait cycle. And you should also use that to decrease velocity. If you are walking too much faster during end of the swing, you should also able to reduce the velocity of the body. So once we understand this purpose of the gait, we can focus on what is the gait cycle. Gait cycle is basically when a single limb forms a heel strike to the next heel strike. So it is a gait cycle from heel strike of right leg to the heel strike of left leg, or heel strike of left leg to the heel strike of left leg, next heel strike. So this is a typical gait cycle which is repeated again and again. And one gait cycle is been traditionally classified or subdivided into two phases, stance phase and swing phase. And stance phase is divided in 5 phases, and swing phase is divided into 3 phases. This is a typical traditional classification. It is basically based on event. What is the event occurring in the particular gait cycle? Like if it is a heel strike, which is the heel is getting touched, that is why it is called heel strike, foot plat, mid stance, heel off or toe up. Like this, all these are event based. But because they are event based, sometimes the event may or may not occur. Then what do you call? And it causes a lot of confusion in the understanding and planning of the patient's treatment. So this traditional classification was not very well accepted. So the newer classification, which is RL classification, which is function based. What is the purpose of that particular phase? Based on that, each phase is been defined or named, such as initial contact. Now, initial contact could be anything. May it be the heel strike is in contact, or it is a direct full flat foot is happening, or toe, but technically it is a heel strike. Then loading response. Loading response defines that the person is supposed to start loading now. After the leg touches the ground, there is a loading response. Mid stance is mid stance, which provides stability. Then terminal stance. Now he has to prepare to terminate his stance or loading phase. And pre-swing, basically by this we understand that we have to prepare for the swing phase. So by default, the end of the stance is supposed to prepare for the swing, and the swing phase is divided into initial swing, mid swing and terminal swing. So this is how typically is based on function. And the total gait cycle can be seen like this, from initial contact to terminal swing, as a complete gait cycle. What are the special variables along with that? So the stance and swing is also as a total gait cycle can be divided into double support, single limb support. Again, there is a double support where both the foot are in contact. This is single limb foot contacts. So in a gait, there are 2 times double support happens. And the whole, when the heel strike from right leg to the heel strike of the right leg, next touching, that whole thing is called a stride. And from right heel strike to the left heel strike, it is called a step length. So does the traditional classification, RL classification, are equal or it is same? They are not exactly same, but there is a little bit overlap. They can overlap with each other like this partly, but there is no complete exact overlap. So we don't consider that every heel strike is initial contact. So there is a little bit overlap, but they are not exact. So this point should be kept in the account whenever you are planning any assessment and treatment. So in the gait as a whole, what are the functions of the gait while you are walking of these different phases? So in the stance phase, there are 2 main purposes, such as weight acceptance and single limb support. So the initial contact and loading response, what is the purpose of these 2 phases? Is to accept the weight. And after that, mid stance to the pre-swing, the main purpose is to do the single limb support so that it gives a good stance stability, so that opposite limb can go into the swing phase or limb advancement. So the initial contact, mid swing and terminal swing, what is the purpose? Is to do the limb advancement for the swing, so that we can prepare the opposite leg for next stance phase on the opposite side. So the weight acceptance part, what is the purpose in that? Is that initial limb stability. Whenever you are doing a heel strike, if you are doing heel strike or foot plat, what kind of area of your foot touches the ground is very important. Suppose you land on the lateral border of the foot, so the initial stability is not good, and that is why the weight acceptance get affected and the whole sequence of shock absorption and preservation of momentum goes down, and that's how the people with poor ankle control or on uneven surface, the initial limb stability doesn't occur, and that is why we get ankle twist injuries. So our aim should be in the gait that provide initial stability by doing a good weight acceptance. Then the second aim should be the single limb support. What is single limb support? That for forward progression of the body, the weight over the stationary foot while maintaining the stability. In this phase, we are supposed to maintain stability on the fixed foot. The foot should form a good base of support, or the whole leg is supported and or that whole body is supported. So it forms a good sequence of event, providing a good stance stability. So if you provide a good stance stability, the opposite limb can go for a swing phase. Very commonly, you must have seen that people with hemiplegia, they are able to take a bigger step on hemiplegic side compared to the unaffected side, because the affected side forms a good base of support. That is why the hemiplegic can take a bigger step from the opposite leg. But when they are doing a swing phase from the unaffected side, the affected side does not give good single limb support, and that is why the unaffected leg cannot take a bigger step. So whenever somebody is having inability to take a bigger step in the swing, the problem is not most of the time on the swing side, the problem is on the stance side, which is basically poor single limb support or poor stance stability. So if you want to improve somebody's step length, instead of focusing on the swing phase of the swing leg, I insist you should focus on the weight acceptance or single limb stance support or stance stability on the stance side, which is the opposite side of the leg. So before we go to the kinetics and kinematics, I want you to follow this basic fundamental principle, because this basic fundamental principle of muscle action will be applied whenever we are discussing about the kinetics or the muscle work. So the first fundamental principle, this is basically we got it from our concepts of understanding of neuro rehab entity, where whenever there is a loading is there or weight bearing is there, extensor group of muscles are working, and whenever there is unloading or not weight bearing, the flexors are working. So we are assuming that whenever there is loading, there is extensors are working, and whenever there are unloading, the flexors are working. This is the first principle. The second principle you should understand for the type of muscle work. So it is basically depends on what is the direction of movement occurring. I am in standing position and I am squatting down. Suppose I am squatting down. So whenever I am in weight bearing, by the first principle, whenever I am weight bearing, who is supposed to work? Extensors. So in my leg, extensors are working, and now I am bending down. So the purpose of extensor was, or the main objective of extensor is to do the extension. But by bending, I am causing flexion. So the muscle work done by the extensor is supposed to be extension, but the movement occurring is a flexion. So it is a opposite direction of movement. So if it is a opposite direction of movement, then it is the eccentric type of contraction. And from squatting down, if I am standing up again and coming up, the direction of movement is occurring is extension. And which muscle are working? Extensor. So the direction of movement is in the same direction. So the type of muscle work is concentric. So this is you are supposed to remember. If the direction of the desired muscle is same as the direction of movement occurring, then it is concentric type of muscle work. And if the direction of movement and the desired muscle action is different or opposite, then it is eccentric. And if there is no movement, then it is isometric muscle contraction. The third principle is breeze and tentacle principle. So the tentacle principle or open chain, you can see these tentacles in the insect. Basically, it is an open chain. The distance is free. So in this, this is called as tentacle. And this is a bridge, which is supposed to be supporting from the bridge from the lower side. So we'll decide, understand this bridge and tentacle principle. This principle says that whenever there is a movement of body forward, suppose I'm moving forward, the upward group of muscle works. So because this is going down, the gravity is supposed to pull down. So this opposite group of muscle is supposed to hold you against the gravity. So whenever we are moving forward, the upper group of muscle are working. Here the upper group of muscle will be extensor, and if you I am moving backward, the upper group of muscle which should work to prevent the body from falling backward, so in that case will be the flexors. So this is what we are supposed to remember. Whenever we move forward or backward in an open chain, the upper group of muscle work to prevent your collapse or going down towards the ground, which is the force of gravity which is going to pull downward. The muscle has to work to maintain your body upright or upward so that we don't collapse. So any forces which are occurring against the gravity are always from the upward side, because the gravity is pulling us downward. So this is the first principle we are supposed to remember, which is the tentacle principle. Now the bridge principle. Suppose I move forward. Once I move forward, by the first rule, the back muscles or the extensors group of muscle on the back, which is upper group of muscle, will work. But the moment you touch the table, you form a bridge. Now it is a bridge. It's been formed, so it becomes closed chain. So the moment you form a bridge, this bridge will cause change in the muscle action. Suddenly from the extensor, the flexor group of or the downward group of muscle will start working. So whenever there's a bridge, downward group of muscle is working. Whenever there is open area like a tentacle, the upward group of muscles are working. This concept is given by Patricia Davis in the book called as Right in the Middle. So now I want you to take a paper and pen and draw this diagram. So on the left side, you are supposed to draw the joint, like right a joint, hip, knee and ankle. On the right side here, upward column, you can write initial contact, loading response, mid stance, terminal stance, pre-swing, initial swing, mid swing or terminal swing. So once you write the table, you are supposed to now remember the kinematics. So how to remember the kinematics? First of all, don't remember only. It is very simple. You can stand on your own and do the phases of different gait cycle. Like this is an initial contact. So what do you do in an initial contact? You just touch your heel and put leg forward. So like this, the moment you put the leg forward and you look at your leg, and the moment you look at your leg, you will understand the hip is going up to 30 degrees of flexion, knee is zero and ankle is zero. So this is how, by just doing on yourself, you can see 30, 0, 0. Next, you are moving your weight forward on the leg. So whenever you move forward weight on the foot, the hip goes from 30 degrees of flexion to less flexion, that is 20 degrees of flexion. Knee goes into 15 degrees of flexion, and the ankle goes in two parts. Because you can see that the heel was in the air, so first it will go downwards. So it goes around 10 to 15 degrees of plantar flexion. The red or negative is shown is extension movement, and the black is showing flexion movement. So first it goes into plantar flexion, and once the body's weight goes on the foot and the tibia moves over the fixed foot, then the dorsiflexion occurs, and this dorsiflexion movement can be ranging from 5 to 15 degrees. So for our simple understanding sake, we have taken this average number here, 20, 15, 15 and 15, minus 15 plus 15. Next, mid stance. Basically it is 0, 0, 0, or you can write 5, 5, 5. The knee is in some degree of flexion because it is also one of the determinants of gait which keeps the knee into flexion so that it doesn't allow the upward translation of center of mass. So the knee is in flexion, so that is why the hip and knee goes in some degrees of flexion. So mid stance is always 5, 5, 5. And once you move your body weight forward and the opposite legs goes into heel strike, your hip goes into extension, which is minus 20 degrees of hip extension, and the knee and ankle goes in 0, 0. So here the kinematics minus 20, 0, 0. From there, you let go, like you move the body weight on the mid stance of the opposite leg, and the hip and knee, the leg actually mechanically falls here. So it falls in due to the gravity or pendular actions. It goes down, and we move from minus 20 degrees of hip extension to the 0 degrees of flexion of hip, and the knee goes into 40 degrees of flexion, and ankle goes into 20 degrees of plantar flexion. So from this to this, we are doing the push-up phase. where from the 0 degrees of flexion we are going to the 20 degrees of plantar flexion. So this pushes our body forward, and from there we'll go to, which is basically, it is a pre-swing, so it is preparing for the swing. So from there the hip goes into 20 degrees of flexion, knees goes into 60 degrees of flexion, and ankle remains into 10 degrees of plantar flexion or 0 degrees of plantar flexion. So this is how the ankle remains here. And after initial swing, we go into the mid swing. So in mid swing, the hip is 30, knee is 30, and ankle is 0. So 30, 30, 0. And the last is always same as the initial quantum, 30, 0, 0. So you can remember these numbers very easily here. Remember, this average, these kinematics are basically taken from different book and just made a simple number so that we can understand. This is just average of a range of different kinematics. So this is what I did to remember very easily, like 30, 0, 0, 20, 15, 15, 5, 5, 5, 20, 0, 0, 0, 40, 20, 20, 60, 10, 30, 30, 0, 30, 0, 0. So you can see that these two are very easy to remember. This is also very easy number to remember. So you have to remember only these two. And once you remember this, other thing you can easily remember. Most of the Google gives you the range. These are the average out number I have taken just to remember so that we can apply this into clinical application very easily. But there is always a kinematics which is range, like the initial contact, the hip flexion can move from 20 to 30 degrees. So there is a range of movement which is occurring. Like mid stance, the hip goes from 0 to 5 degrees. Here, like the dorsiflexion and plantar flexion, maybe 5 to 15 degrees of range. Same for plantar flexion as well as dorsiflexion. Or the terminal stance, the ankle can be into 10 degrees of plantar flexion to 0 degrees of dorsiflexion. Or in pre-swing, the ankle can move from 20 to 30 degrees of plantar flexion. So whenever you are talking about, you are supposed to remember there is a range. Around 5 to 10 degrees of variation is always there in all the kinematics of gait. Because these kinematics of the gait are dependent on your, what is your height. So now we'll revise this again. So as we have discussed in previous figure, if you look at this, what is the kinematics here? It is 30, 0, 0. Then next is 20, 15, minus 15, and 15. Mid stance is 0, 0, 0, or you can say 5, 5, 5. Terminal stance, you are minus 20, 0, 0. Pre-swing will be, your hip comes to the neutral, so 20, 40, and 20. Initial swing will be 20, 60, and minus 10. Mid swing will be 30, 30, 0, and terminal swing will be 30, 0, 0. So this is the typical kinematics which happens in most of the average out gait. And once you remember this, based on this, we can talk about the kinetics very easily. So this will be the whole table which will be used for our reference whenever we are talking about the kinematics or the muscle work. So after you draw the first table, you can keep the tables aside. And now we are supposed to discuss in different parts. Muscle work is not defined in single phase like initial contact, loading response. It is always the transition. That is how it is, the muscle work is defined. So here we are moving from initial contact to the loading response. So what are the kinematics for the initial contact to loading response? So you can look at these figures and you can put that here. So what was the kinematic? 30, 0, 0. And loading response was 20, 15, 15, and 15. So if you look at this, now on the topmost side, it is joint, initial contact, loading response, and movement. What kind of movement is occurring? So here you need to understand what is the movement happening. What is happening here? You are moving from 30 degrees of flexion to 20 degrees of flexion. You are still in the flexion, but what is the movement happen from more flexion to less flexion? So technically it is extension. So the movement happened is extension. And look at this principle, because we are in loading, because you are in mid stance, most of the time the body is weight bearing. So in loading response, who works? Extensors work. So here extension movement happened and extensor are working. So the type of muscle work will be, because the direction is the same. So because we are moving in the same direction, the muscle work will be concentric. So now we'll move from 0 to 15. So from more flexion, zero flexion, we are going to 15 degrees of flexion. So movement occurred is flexion. And which phase we are in? Stance phase. So the which muscle are going to work? So remember, this muscle work throughout the stance, you are supposed to talk extensor, extensor, extensor. So don't bother about thinking too much. You put extensor directly. So extensor. But if you look at the muscle working, or movement happened is flexion, but the muscle working are extensor. So by this principle, we are in the opposite direction. So we are in opposite direction. So type of muscle work will be eccentric. So now from 0 degrees of flexion, we are moving to plantar flexion, which is minus 15 degrees of plantar flexion. So the movement occurred is extension. But remember here, the foot was in the air. So if the foot was in the air, are we in loading? No. So we were not in the loading. So if you are not in the loading, which muscle work? Flexor. So here, instead of saying extensor are working, what we are supposed to say? Flexor. So by this principle, again, the movement happened is extensor, but the muscle working are flexor. So the movement occurred is opposite. So type of muscle contraction is eccentric. Last, so from minus 15 degree or extension, plantar flexion of 15 degrees, we are moving to 15 degrees of flexion. So from extension, we move to the flexion. So movement occurred is flexion. But in this, we started loading. So the body started loading. So whenever there is a loading, which muscle work? Extensors work. So the muscle work is extensor. By the principle of this muscle work, second principle, the movement is occurring in the opposite direction. So the type of muscle work will be eccentric. So this is how, if you remember, whenever there is a loading, extensor work, and you look at the kinematics, which direction moving, flexion or extension, and once you write this, if these two are same word, so then you should be concentric. If these two are opposite word, you should talk about eccentric work. So this is how simply you can understand the muscle work whole gait, if you understand or remember the kinematics, these numbers easily. So we'll move to the loading response to mid stance. So we'll copy the figures from here. So 20, 15, minus 15. From there, we want to 15 degrees of dorsiflexion. So that is why it is 15 degrees of dorsiflexion here. To the mid stance, which is 5, 5, 5. So if you look at from more flexion, we want to less flexion. So movement happened is extension. Muscle working, extensor. Type of muscle work, concentric. So from here, more flexion to less flexion. Movement happened is extension. Muscle working, extensor. Type of muscle work, concentric. So from ankle, 15 degrees of dorsiflexion, we move to 5 degrees of dorsiflexion. So the movement happened is extension, and we are in weight bearing, so extensor working. So type of muscle work, concentric. So mid stance to the terminal stance. Again, we'll copy the figures from here to here. So mid stance is 5, 5, 5, and terminal stance will be minus 20, or hip extension 0, 0. So from flexion, we move to extension. So the movement occurred is extension. Muscle working, because we are weight bearing, extensor. Type of muscle work, concentric. So from the 20 degrees of flexion, we move to 0. So the movement occurred is extension. Muscle working, extensor. So type of muscle work, concentric. So again, from 5 degree to 0. So the movement happened is extension. Muscle working, extensors. Type of muscle work, concentric. So from terminal stance to pre-swing. So terminal stance to pre-swing. So we'll take figures from here. So terminal stance was minus 20, 0, 0. And pre-swing was 0, 40 and minus 20. So we from more extension to flexion. So movement happened is flexion. Muscle working, because you are in weight bearing, extensors. The type of muscle supposed to be eccentric, because the movement happened is opposite. So from more less flexion to more flexion. So basically the movement happened is flexion, but which muscle are working? Extensors. So type of muscle work? Eccentric. So ankle from 0 degrees of flexion, we move to more plantar flexion. So the movement happened is extension, and extensor are working, which is the plantar flexion, plantar flexor. So the type of muscle work will be concentric. So now we'll move from pre-swing to initial swing. So this is pre-swing, initial swing. So take figures from here. So 0, 40 and minus 20. Initial swing is 20, 60 and 10. So this green is showing stance period, and the orange is showing the swing phase. So we move from 0 to 20, which is a flexion movement. Movement happened is flexion. Because we are moving towards the swing phase, the muscle work will be flexors. Type of muscle will be concentric. So from 40 degrees to 60 degrees, the movement happened is flexion. And in swing, which works from this principle is flexor. Direction is same, so concentric. So from minus 20 degrees of flexion, we go on to minus 10 degrees of flexion. So basically it is a flexion movement. So the muscle working will be flexor, so the concentric muscle work. So this is what, if you see, understand, in the swing, when we are moving from pre-swing to swing, all concentric muscle work is happening. So we'll move from initial swing to the mid swing. So initial swing is 20, 60 and minus 10, to mid swing 30, 30, 0. So from 20 degrees of flexion, we move to more flexion. The movement happened is flexion, muscle working flexor, concentric. So from more flexion, we move to less flexion. The movement happened is extension, but the muscle working are flexor. So the muscle work is supposed to be eccentric. Here, from 10 degrees of flexion, we move to minus 10 degrees of flexion, we move to 0 degrees. So that is flexion movement. So movement happened is flexion, and muscle working are dorsiflexor, flexor. So that muscle action is concentric. Mid swing to terminal swing. So mid swing is 30, 30, 0 to 30, 0, 0, 0. So from 30 to 30, any movement happened? No. So no movement. So type of muscle work, because the flexors are working in the swing, so type of muscle work will be isometric. So from 30 degree, we move to 0. So the movement happened is extension. Now we are in extension. We are in swing phase, so the flexors supposed to be work, but there is a defaulter here, because although we are in the air, but the movement is happening against the gravity. So because the movement is happening against the gravity, the extensors comes into play here, which causes knee extension. This is the only defaulter to our law of swing here. So the extension is happening here, and extensors are working. So the type of muscle work will be concentric of the quadricep. And this extension is being checked by the eccentric action of the hamstring, so that the knee doesn't or the foot doesn't go too much into extension. So the action of two muscles happening here. The initiation of movement is caused by concentric of quadricep, and check action is done by the eccentric of hamstring. Ankle, because ankle is in the air and it is remaining in the same position, the 0-0, no movement. You are in the air, flexors are working, and the isometric muscle work is happening. So by this mechanism, we actually easily understand what is the muscle work is happening in most of the gait. Is it concentric or eccentric? What movement is happening and which muscles are working? So these are the active muscles or the active forces which are working on our body. But it is not always that the active muscles are continuously working. Whenever you are in a motion, whenever you are in the momentum, this muscle does not work. There are a lot of passive forces are also working, which also helps in the gait. Maybe initiation of movement is caused by all what are the muscle we have discussed, but once you are in the motion, this muscle work goes down. Remember, one of the basic principle or purpose of the gait, that reduce energy expenditure. Because in walking, our body doesn't want to work more, so we need to use non-active forces, such as passive forces. So what are the passive forces which are using here? Momentum, gravity and pendulum. So understand, we'll go to first loading response to the mid stance.
from loading response of flexion, we are moving to the extension. This extension is supposed to be caused by the extensors, but because we are in the motion, this is basically caused by the momentum. So technically, there is no muscle work of hip extensor work here. So hip extensors are only working from initial contact to the loading response. After that, you can see that there is no muscle work. So this muscle extension of the hip is caused by momentum. Also here, the quadriceps are working from here to here for the eccentric contraction of quadriceps to keep the knee into flexion. But from this flexion of the knee, when we move towards the extension of the knee, this is also the extension is caused by the momentum, because the upper body is moving to extension here and forward propulsion is happening, the knee extension here also, the quadricep from loading response to midstand doesn't require. Same from midstance to the terminal stance. So your body is in progression. So the body is moving forward. Because the body is moving forward, the leg is falling behind. The hip extension is caused because the body is moving forward. So although there is a hip extension occurring here, this extension is not caused by the extensor. So that is why you can see that there is no muscle action here. So this hip extension is also caused by hip extension, by the momentum. So we studied in previous slide that the hip extensors are supposed to work from midstand to terminal stand, but in momentum, you do not require hip extensors. Now you can see that plantar flexors were not working here, but here the plantar flexor starts from the loading response till the terminal stance. The plantar flexors are working to push your body forward. Here they first work eccentrically here, and after that it is concentric of plantar flexor to do the push up. So now from terminal stance to pre-swing. From terminal stance to pre-swing, when the body moves forward, the force which is, or the GRF which is going from this leg, there the push up phase ends here, the muscle contraction stops here, and the femur and the leg mechanically falls down due to the effect of gravity. So this knee flexion from 0 degrees of flexion to 40 degrees of flexion is not actually caused by hip flexor, sorry, knee flexor or quadriceps eccentric. It is mainly caused by the gravity. So here the gravity is coming into picture. Sometime the rectus gets mild activation to provide eccentric action to support the stability of the foot. So we should always remember this is passive knee flexion, and this is where we forget in our hemiplegic. From terminal stance or unlocking the knee is supposed to be passive mechanism, not the active mechanism of the hamstrings. So why there is a passive mechanism working? Because the opposite leg gone more forward. As I told you in previous lecture, because the stance stability on the hemiplegic is not good, so the opposite leg step length is reduced. If the opposite step length is reduced, the leg will fall here, and this mechanical falling of the knee doesn't occur, and the unloading from this knee doesn't occur, and that is why the passive knee flexion doesn't occur in hemiplegic, and that is why they have difficulty in hip knee flexion, and that affects their swing phase, and that affects their swing activity, and to compensate that they do the circumduction. So please focus on the passive knee flexion here or unlocking here. In the last part, now we cause the knee flexion here and the hip goes into more flexion, and from here the tibia is going from 40 degrees of flexion to more 60 degrees of flexion, and then from 60 degrees of flexion to 30 degrees of flexion. This movement, when you flex the hip, the tibia is moving as a pendulum. So tibia is moving as a pendulum. This is how the hip is in the beginning, and if the more you flex the hip, the knee goes into more flexion. So the from 40 degree to 60 degrees of flexion is occurred because of pendular action of the tibia more than the knee flexors, which is causing the knee flexion, which is from initial contact to the mid swing. With from 40 degrees of knee flexion to 60 degrees of knee flexion is due to pendular action or more hip flexion. So here also you should remember, we always focus in swing to focus or train more the hamstring to cause more knee flexion, instead of causing or working on knee flexion with the hamstrings. I suggest work on more of hip flexion. The more you cause the hip flexion, the tibia will automatically fall into pendular action of flexion, and you will get a good swing. So the last passive force is a pendular action. So remember, in most of the gait, we get lot of momentum acting here, and here it is more of gravity which is helping us, and here the pendulum is helping us to cause the movement. So in throughout the gait, not all the muscle are continuously working. There are a lot of passive forces are working and helping us to move the body forward. So at last we'll talk about in which period the muscles are working in different phases. If you look at this is the swing, the phases of the gait, and this is the different muscle works from the hip, knee and ankle. This is hip extensor, hip flexor, knee extensor, knee flexor, ankle extensors and ankle flexors, dorsiflexor. So if you look at this, the hip extensors are mainly working from initial contact to loading response. In only in initiation of the gait or when you start slow, then only they work till the mid stance. Otherwise this loading response to mid stance work is mainly done by the momentum. After that the hip extensor doesn't work. Hip flexors, they start working from pre swing and they work throughout the swing phase. Knee extensors only work from initial contact to loading response. So from 0 degrees of flexion to the 15 degrees of flexion during loading, so there is a eccentric contraction of the quadricep. So the quadricep works in the initial contact to loading response. From loading response to mid stance, quadricep actually doesn't work. So very commonly we assume that the knee extension or hyperextension of the knee is caused by weakness or overactivation of quadricep. So that is not actually true here, because the muscle actually is not active here. So we do not require too much of quadriceps work in this if you are using good momentum. And quadriceps are working only from mid swing to terminal swing to cause the terminal extension of the knee, so that the knee and the foot is prepared for next stance phase. And the hamstrings are working in the end only to cause the check action of the quadricep. So if you see, the knee flexors are not working at all, neither in the swing phase. So the swing phase is actually not caused by the knee flexor or hamstring. So we do not need to work on knee flexor to cause a more swing. We need to work more on hip flexor or hip flexion movement. So ankle extensors. So the ankle extensors doesn't work in the initial contact. They start from the loading response and they work till the pre-swing. And this, there is too much of, first it is eccentric contraction here, and there is too much of concentric contraction work here. If you look at the width, so that is why I kept the width little bit larger, so that the amount of muscle work done by plantar flexor is too much. Dorsiflexors work in the beginning, which is the eccentric contraction. The ankle was, which was in the air, and then it goes slowly down. So the eccentric of dorsiflexor, after that the dorsiflexors start working from the pre-swing till the terminal swing. So this is the muscle work happening throughout the gait. So if you understand, see, there are so many muscles are not active throughout the gait. But if you look at ankle, you can see that out of the whole stance, at least 80% is covered by the plantar flexor, and out of the swing, 100% is covered by the dorsiflexor. So the muscle work required in the ankle is very much important, and after that the muscle work required in the hip is very much important, and the muscle work required in the knee is very much less, because knee is an intermediate joint and it always react to what is happening in the hip or ankle. So if you focus on the kinetics and kinematics of the ankle and hip, you will solve the problems around the knee very easily. So this is the end of the today's session. Today's objective was just to make you understand what are the different types of muscle work and which phases the muscles are acting and which phases are the muscles are not acting. In next lecture we'll be doing some live demo on models, or I will do the movement and I will explain you how to mimic the different phases of gait, like initial contact, loading response, mid stance, and it will make you understand how does the muscle work is acting, and I will allow you to practice along with me. So prepare yourself next time so that you have more space and you can keep your phone in a stable position so that you can watch me and then practice with me, and then we'll discuss a little bit about what are the kinematics can be explained by the 3D gait analysis, and kinetics or the muscle work which is explained in 3D gait analysis. We'll also be talking about the passive forces such as ground reaction forces and the rockers. What is the role of rocker in improving the momentum or the smooth rhythmic gait? So if you are interested in understanding this in more detail in a very simple ways, please tune on with us. If you like these videos and you want to learn more about the gate, or if you want to make your understanding about neural rehab simple, then please subscribe our channel. Every time, all Thursdays, 9:30 p.m. We'll be live on neural rehab lectures, and in this we'll talk about different neural rehab lectures. Right now in the neural rehab we are talking about neuroplasticity series is going on, and on Saturdays we'll be talking about gait and biomechanics. So book your Saturdays and Thursdays 9:30 p.m. for the lectures, and you can see us live on YouTube, or we'll be conducting a Zoom meeting, and this information will be notified on our Facebook page and our YouTube channel. So if you like our efforts, and if you understand what I explained to you today, and if it is making your life easy, please do subscribe our channel and give your feedback. If anybody has any question, you can ask your question in the chat box. I can't find any question in the chat box. Anybody want to ask the question, please put your question in the chat so that I can attend your questions right now live. I think there are no questions, and if you have any questions, please you can put these questions in the chat box, and whenever I find, I will answer your question in the comment section. Please subscribe to our channel and give your genuine feedback. How did you like our lectures? And one of the GP school's aim is that making neuro rehab simple, making your understanding about the gait and biomechanics simple. If I am able to make gait and neuro rehab lecture simple, please give your feedback. Thank you very much. I am closing the session.